Hi friends, so welcome back to sagalavidya.com. So in today's session, let us have a discussion how to solve numerical problems in our chapter 4, that is design of compression members. Design of compression members. So for example, we are going to get a question saying that I have to find the design compressive strength of a column when a section is given. So the first and foremost step, you have to write the given data. Step 1. So what is the step 1? Given data. So this given data, directly we can copy or we can write from the steel table book. For a section, mostly we are going to get I section, that is like ISMB or ISHB, etc. So for this section, you have to write all the basic data from our steel table book. So what is your step one? You have to write given data. For example, for that section, we have to write area of the section, area of the section, that is capital A, whose units will be mm square, and next we have to write depth of the section, depth of the section, that is as capital H. Next, width of the flange, width of the flange, it is designated as B suffix F, again units will be in mm. Next, thickness of the flange, thickness of the flange, it is designated as T suffix F, again units will be mm. Radius of gyration in ZZ direction and radius of gyration in YY direction, and also we have to write momentum of inertia in XX direction, units will be mm power 4, and momentum of inertia in YY direction, units will be in mm power 4. So by seeing that question, we have to write all the basic data. We can copy directly from our steel table book. Directly we can copy from our steel table book. So for example, if this is our I section, which is given to solve the design compressive strength that is going to act on the section. For example, if this is our I section, you have to write all the basic properties such as depth of the section, next width of the flange, thickness of the flange, thickness of the web, radius of gyration, etc. So what is the first and foremost step? The first step, you have to write given data. So this is our first and foremost step. Step 2 in solving a question. Step 2 is effective length. This effective length plays an important role in solving slenderness ratio. It plays an important role in slenderness ratio. Sorry, I'm suffering with cold. So based upon different types of end conditions, like end conditions will be given as if both the ends are fixed, or one end is fixed or another end is free, both the ends are pinned, or one end is pinned, another end is fixed, we're going to have different types of end conditions. So these are called as end conditions. So based upon these end conditions, we have to write or we have to solve for effective length. So effective length is equal to some factor is multiplied with given length. So directly we can obtain this effective length in our IS 800 2007. You have to follow table number 11 for this effective length condition. In our code book, IS 800 2007. Let us see that table. So this is our effective length table, which lies in page number 45, which lies in page number 45. So based upon this table, based upon this end conditions, see, the first column consists of boundary conditions. The first column consists of boundary conditions, and next consists of its schematic representation or diagram, and next it consists of effective length, the formulae that we have obtained. So boundary conditions, the first column is boundary conditions, next one is schematic representation, and the last one is effective length. So based upon this, we have to design a structure. So we have to use this table number 11 for finding this effective length. So one end is fixed, one end is pinned, another end is having roller support, two ends are hinged, one is fixed, other end is roller. So we're having different types of end conditions. For writing this effective length, you have to follow table number 11, page number 45. Page number 45. So this is our step 2. Now let us go for step 3. So what is our step 3? So step 3. Step 3 is very, very important, and it is based upon table number 10. It is based upon table number 10, page number 44. So this step 3 is very important, whether to find the classification of the section, to find the classification of section, whereas it is whether it belongs to class A or class B or class C or class D. So based upon some formulas, we're going to find whether the given section belongs to class A or class B or class C or class D. So for that, we have to refer table number 10, page number 44. Let us see the table number 10. So this is our table number 10. So table number 10 is completely meant for buckling class classification of a cross section. So for example, if the question is rolled eye section, then we have to follow these limits, buckling axis and buckling class. So class A, class B, class D, we're going to get based upon these limits. For welded eye section, we have to follow this column. Whereas for hollow section, we have to follow this column. So based upon this, we have to use step 3, that is step 3. For that, we have to use table number 10, page number 44, whether the given section belongs to class A or class B or class C. So mostly we're going to get, we have to follow, as in question will be given as welded section, we have to follow the formula as depth by width ratio. So based upon depth by width ratio, if it is greater than or equal to 1.2, then we have to see whether the given section belongs to C. If depth by width ratio is greater than is 1.2, then it belongs to class A. If thickness of the flange is less than or equal to 40 mm, then it belongs to class B. If the depth by width ratio is less than 1.2, then it becomes class B. So based upon this depth by width ratio plays an important role, and it is a deciding factor, and it says whether the given section is class A or class B or class C. So our step 3 is nothing but classification of section. And next, step 4, effective slenderness ratio, So in step 3, we're going to get either class A or class B or class B or class C. We're going to obtain two classes. In step 3, we're going to obtain two classes. So based upon step 3, we're going to solve for step 4. For example, if I'm going in step 3, for example, we're going to get, for example, if it is class A and class B, then ineffective slenderness ratio, ineffective slenderness ratio, our formulae becomes effective length divided by radius of gyration in zz direction and effective length by radius of gyration in yy direction. So based upon this we are going to get some values, right? Isn't it? So for this we have to refer class A table. For this we have to refer class B table. So this class A, class B, class C tables we are going to get in page number some like 36, 37, 38, 39, 40. So our last step, that is step 5, before finding design compressive strength, step 5, so based upon our effective slenderness ratio, you have to find design compressive stress, FCD. FCD, you have to find the value of FCD, Newton per mm square. You have to find the value of FCD, Newton per mm square, based upon, in this example, I'm going to write as class A, for example, class A and class B. So in order to find the value of FCD, the FCD is nothing but design compressive stress. FCD is nothing but design compressive stress. So these values, design compressive stress values, are obtained by using table number 9. A, 9A is for class A, table number 9B for class B. For example, if it is class C, then we have to refer 9C. If it is class D, then we have to refer table number 9D. I'll show you. So these are the tables that we have to follow. For example, table number 9D, design compressive stress, FCD for column buckling. So the first row indicates the effective slenderness ratio, and here we're going to have this 200, 210, 220, so on up to 510. These are nothing but our yield stress. So based upon yield stress and effective slenderness ratio, you're going to find the value of design compressive stress. So whichever is lesser, so among this class A or class B, so whichever is lesser among them is going to become our design compressive stress. So lesser among step 5, whichever is lesser, that becomes our design compressive stress. So our last and final step, that is step 6, design compressive strength. So design compressive strength. So it is denoted as P suffix D. So what is the formula for that? P suffix D is nothing but compressive stress is multiplied with area of the section. Area of the section. The units will be newtons or kilonewtons. Now let us recap our different steps that we have seen now. The first and foremost step, that is you have to write the given data based upon the section. So the given data is obtained from which book? Steel table book. So definitely have to carry your steel table book for your exam. So step 2, the effective length. So based upon the end conditions of the column, we're going to find this formulae. We're going to find these values in table number 11 in code book, that is IS 800-2007. So some factor is multiplied with given length, then it becomes effective length. And next, step 3. Step 3 is mostly useful for finding or classification of the section, whether the given section belongs to class A or class B or class C. So based upon this, it is obtained by depth by width. So this is our step 3. Step 3 is very, very important. And step 4, effective slenderness ratio. So as we are going to have two radius of gyration in ZZ direction and YY direction, we are going to obtain two effective slenderness ratio. Based upon this, again, we have to follow class A, class B or class C or class D tables, that is table number 9A or 9B or 9C or 9D. So mostly we are going to get two classes, either A or B or B or C or A or D. So among these two, whichever is lesser, that is our design compressive stress. FCD is nothing but design compressive stress. So whichever is lesser among that step number five, that is our design compressive stress. The last step, that is design compressive strength, PD. PD is nothing but the design compressive stress multiplied with the area of the section gives our PD. PD is nothing but design compressive strength, that which that given column can withstand or it can bear the load. So now let us calculate some numerical problems in our design of columns and compression members.